Hello and welcome to a special conversation of the News Minute. Ahead of the elections, we decided to speak to people about what they really care about. I'm sure across news platforms, you have seen how Bengaluru city, all three seats, north, central and south, are witnessing very, very high voltage battles. In the north, we have Shobha Karanlaje versus Rajiv Gowda. In central, Bengaluru central, we have PC Mohan versus Mansoor Ali Khan. And of course, Bengaluru south, Soumya Reddy, who's challenging Tejaswi Surya. But this is a city with many, many, many problems. And you know, as much as we want to talk about it, come elections, somehow all these problems get neglected, they get pushed to the margins, and it's all about the politics. We decided to change that, and we have with us to discuss the problems of Bengaluru a very small but diverse panel. Young students who are studying law, a working professional, and somebody who's worked for decades in the gender space. Before I introduce you to them, I'll also take you across to my colleague, Anisha, who heads our Karnataka Bureau. And the reason I want to first talk to Anisha is because she's written a very, very important and crucial piece about Bengaluru South. Anisha, I want to ask you, you know, when we talk about Bangalore South, this is a constituency where, you know, usually we talk about culture and Vidyarthi Bhavan Dose and, you know, Bisi Bisi Coffee, right? That's piping hot coffee for those who are not familiar. You've spoken to people in the margin and you've exposed how Bengaluru South is so much more than that. Tell us about that.
The approach I started out with was to look at the people who've slipped within the cracks, have slipped between the cracks, so to say. That is one aspect that I was looking at, but there's also another thing that I wanted to make visible, which is how prominent social identities actually are, and the urban myth that, you know, caste and class do not exist. That is something that I wanted to make visible, and that's what I tried to do by talking to as many people as I could. Many of them haven't actually made it to the story because, well, for word length, we had to remove a lot of things.
Yeah, but that said, your story, your copy talks is the most diverse one you can find on Bengaluru South as on today. We'll come back to have a conversation more about that. Ma'am, apart from the civic issues which all of us speak so much about, I want to know from you, what is that one big issue that you want addressed in Bengaluru today?
In the south or in the whole of Bangalore?
South, across Bengaluru, whatever.
I look at it as an issue of development. Mm-hmm. And what is that paradigm of development that we're talking about? Mm-hmm. Because when you see all over, you see flyovers, you see the metro, you see all this kind of development. But at what cost? Because just yesterday we were at a place where housing has mm-hmm. been given. Mm-hmm. But the housing that has been given has no water, no sanitation, absolutely nothing. Mm-hmm. So then you can talk that there is housing. Yeah. You can talk there is economic weaker sections housing. But yet the reality is that does not suffice because it is not the real kind of housing that anyone would like to live in. So the living standards of people, the issues of the living standards, issues of price rise in Bangalore is very, very important. The issue of water, of course, and the issue of land. I mean, land for housing.
So more holistic approach to development. Is that
yeah, more holistic approach to development.
We'll talk a little bit more. I want to ask the youngsters, are you a first-time voter? You voted before?
I voted before. I voted in the Karnataka state elections, but this is going to be my first time voting in the union elections.
Right. So what is it that you look at when you vote? Do you look at the candidate? Do you look at the party? Or you look at who can, you know, talk about the issues that you can relate with the most?
I most probably look forward to the candidate that is usually put across mm-hmm. in the constituencies.
Yeah.
I represent, or the candidates that are representing my constituency, that's Bangalore Central, is PC Mohan and Dr. Mansoor Khan, if I'm not wrong. Mm-hmm. And to be very honest, I've lived there all my life. And Mr. PC Mohan has been elected at least 3 or 4 times, if I'm not wrong. But I've never seen him once on a campaign trail. You see, in fact, most of the people that live in the area, whether it's Indranagar, Tumlur, or any of those areas, I've never seen him. In fact, most of the neighbors around, whether it's citizens above the age of 30 or whether it's first-time voters, usually vote based upon the party. They are not concerned about the constituency and the person who's representing the constituency. And I feel like that in itself is a problem because an MP or an MLA, he or she is supposed to represent you, not the political party. I know there's a larger agenda at hand, but if they do not put their constituency first, then it ends up in putting their constituency last and just goes, you know, no development.
How does a citizen get impacted by this? If for example, you said you've not seen PC Mohan, who's your MP, like many people in your area. So is it because, you feel you're not accessible if you don't look at the candidate and vote? Is that a...
No, ma'am. I think it's also largely the track record that one puts out, in order to help for them to get voted again. In fact, Indiranagar and Bangalore Central as a whole, including the Central Business District, is a very diverse district. It has a multitude of problems, whether it's traffic management, whether it's potholes, or whether simply because of the fact that housing in itself has become a concern with a large number of migrants coming in from South India and all across the country having no place to live, right? In itself becomes a problem. And the track record, we've given them multiple chances, right? Track record has not been great. And in fact, the political candidate must come and convince us as to why we have to vote for them. It's not upon just, okay, I'm representing a political party, hence I have to vote. And it's been the same for Congress as well. Congress has sort of neglected Bangalore Centre as a potential seat for them to win, simply because they believe that the candidate that BJP places is a formidable candidate. And they've sort of also lost the battle in itself when they put out a candidate that nobody knows, or they simply do not, think that it matters enough.
They don't put any effort at all. Ma'am. Very, very strong words. I hope both the BJP and the Congress are listening to this young man and pay a little more attention to candidate selection. A young woman like yourself, I want to know from you, one, do people around you of your age group, do they talk about politics? Do they care about politics at all? Or is it about other issues like your college and getting jobs and things like that?
I think it's a very sad state of affairs because not a lot of people talk about politics. I think it's mostly, a select few who actually understand what's happening. I'm from a law college and it's like only a formidable few who actually know what's happening in the country, that the elections are happening. And even if they do not know about politics, they usually tend to, perceive their views based on posts on Instagram or something that attracts attention. So I think that way, I don't think a lot of youngsters know what's happening in the country, which is a very sad thing. And I think it should definitely, be a very major issue.
This is your first general election as well?
Voting. Yes, I voted for the state elections, but this is my first national elections.
So what does a young first-time voter of a general election, what is it that you care about?
I think the same thing that everyone cares about. For example, jobs. We are not getting good jobs. There's not enough. As everyone else said, very bad housing. And especially with regards to Karnataka, there's not a lot of, there's a water shortage happening. And the GDP is at a staggering, a very bad point. And I think that really saddens me. And I think we need to vote for a party that could change that, that could, bring in some, that could actually give jobs to people. Having a high GDP does not reflect the per capita income of the people of a nation. And especially with regards to minority issues as well, I think that's a very starkly sad problem in our country where minorities are being targeted, caste issues are not being considered or taken up. We need a caste census, none of which are happening. So I think a party which can do that, I would vote for it.
I want to ask you, you're a working professional. So she said, jobs are something they vote for. I was speaking to a few candidates a couple of days ago and they kept saying that this is a national election. It was a BJP candidate and it's Modi's election. So do you feel that at the end of the day, it's somewhere become presidential? At this point, or do you still care about local issues?
I think it's been presidential ever since Modi came into power. So I think that's where the shift began, where we started electing representatives based on a single person who's going to lead the country and not care about who's going to represent us. So I think the shift began there. And unfortunately, that's like a very dangerous trend that's been ongoing. And I think a third term for Modi is going to make him more stronger, make him more bolder to take more, irrational choices and put quite a few people's lives at risk.
You said it's dangerous. Why do you think that's dangerous for the people of the country?
Because I think people get blinded by what he represents, the strong nationalist aspect that he portrays. He's a pro-Hindutva person, and these are the wrong things that people tend to vote for. Like my own parents, I'm still not able to sway them to to vote for a sensible candidate, right? Because in their head, Modi represents Hinduism. Modi represents, they don't even care about Hindutva. They are very close Muslim friends. They don't care about them. And in the end, it's like what Modi does for Hindus as a whole, he's okay, build some temple somewhere far away, which I don't know, which most of us will never go. But in the end, like, that's the optics that matters to them. So I think that is very dangerous. They get blinded by it, and they do not focus on the development or people and others.
Ma'am, law and order, of course, is a state subject. But that said, there are certain schemes for women. So this election, I'm seeing increasingly all parties trying to woo women voters. But what are the factors that you would look at? What kind of safety or schemes or, you know, outreach would you like to see from politicians?
See, considering that we work with a large majority of women who are part of the informal sector, So definitely I would look at formalizing their jobs. Because as long as they don't have a labor card, they don't have benefits. So it would be very important. I would look for that, and I've been putting it forward in our demands. The other thing that I would look for definitely is safety, social security. And it is in the informal sector that if you take the street vendors, you take the power karmikas, you take their jobs are so unstable. They've not even been given any permanent job. So where can you live as, you know, how can the woman take care of the family? These schemes have come since 1 year. It has done a lot of benefit. Wherever we went for a campaign, many women were quite excited about it. The only thing is that as long as it just doesn't remain as a scheme, because you know what schemes are. It is one particular party may come and give some schemes. It's not as a right. If it is as a right, then I'm an entitlement, then it is going to be a little more permanent. Right. So therefore, the most important safety, of course, all over, it's the same. At the central level, the Nirbhaya funds that were set aside, more than 1,000 crores, have not yet reached because we directly work with issues. And we have seen these Nirbhaya centers that are not functioning. The Sexual Harassment Act that came up, and a very nice act, maybe because of Bhavadi Devi, a very nice act. But the systems have not been set up for the unorganized sector women, like the local complaints committees. So we are wondering, you have spoken about Nari Shakti. There is this big, huge talk about Nari Shakti, and we are not seeing that the Nari Shakti is meant for only certain kind of women who are belonging maybe to the upper caste, upper class, and who are managing to reach certain echelons of power. But what about the women at who are daily grinding? Now, all the women we met expressed about GST. Whatever little money is coming in, it has become less and less. Whatever money is coming in is also going out. So this whole idea of, the whole thing of safety of women is a very, very crucial thing. And I don't know when they will start paying real detailed attention to it, because it's not on a priority list. As far as women's issues are concerned, are not on a priority.
So, you know, all the speeches, all the schemes, they look like lip service to you at this point.
Some of the schemes have been implemented. But the rest are all, for the time being, in order to make people feel that something is being done for them. After all, we all live on hope. So unfortunately, people are pressurizing on that hope. The politicians are really banking on that hope that they give. So that is the issue, problem. The problem is not that there is nothing. There are some things, but as soon as you give in one thing, it's taken away by another factor. Like if you're given the schemes, you're taking away their incomes. Wage theft is happening. Incomes are being taken away, and jobs are going. So it doesn't match, because you give with one hand, and with the other hand, your life is already being taken for a ride.
Right, Anisha, ma'am spoke about class and caste issues, and this is also something you have found in your conversations. So do voters, based on their class and caste, care about different issues? Is that something? And if that is the case, then can you just kind of break it down for us?
Like, based on the conversations that I've had with people, like say regular folks on the ground and also activists, maybe like even across the state, there are a couple of patterns that I've observed. One is that, see, in some areas, the politicians are there. If the politicians themselves aren't there, it is somebody who is associated with them, which will have like a system of say, okay, can I get my work done through this person, right? So then it doesn't matter who that the party candidate is. Another thing that people have is that there have been instances where politicians have been around and they've actually done work for the people. So that connect is also there, right? And a third pattern is that there have been like in some parts of Bangalore, for in parts of North Bangalore, for instance, I've heard that, you know, the Congress isn't much on the ground, right? But they've seen a lot of people in some of these areas where the migrant population is really high, and that these are migrants from within the state and also from across the state, where, you know, there's something or the other that the extended Sangh Parivar is doing. They're always there, you know, like on the street corner or your tea shop, or one activist was telling me that, you know, January 22nd, when Ayodhya was happening, there was a bunch of people going around putting flags all over the place. So the presence is there, right? So finding a pattern in terms of all of this is a little difficult. Because people are complex. And what happens is that the pattern with regard to caste and class definitely is there in terms of where they live, the kind of life opportunities that they have, and the kind of lived experiences that they have, right? So yeah, that's the, these are my observations.
I want to know, there's something I'm very curious, where do young people get news from? Are you interested in news, you and your friends and your classmates? If you are interested, what's your source?
So mostly our source is, I would say, proper news articles, because...
News articles or newspapers?
Yes, newspapers, whether it is the ANI or any other mainstream news that one subscribes to. Apart from which, you have a lot of students consuming content from content creators. That is, whether it is a Dhruv Rathi or someone else whose ideologies may be different. And I would say the largely apolitical people who say that they are away from politics, they consume their news through social media, whether it is Twitter or whether it is Instagram. Now, why I say this also is because these political parties have found that Twitter, Instagram and WhatsApp and other forms of social media are very, you know, promising in terms of converting voter base. Whether if you look at the past voter campaigns, or whether it's BJP or the Congress, all of them have started making memes on each other. All of them have started putting out satire.
Which is exactly why I asked you this question. So what is it that in your circle is being discussed about Bangalore elections?
At this point of time, since a large number of students that I have are coming from all over the country, whether it's Tamil Nadu, Kerala, Northeast, Bihar, Uttar Pradesh, the politics is not that discussed. But among students that are predominantly from Bangalore, it is how Bangalore in itself is losing its credibility as a capital. When I mean that, it is when we're not able to tackle basic civic woes that plague us, whether it is just if there is rainwater stagnating at a particular place, we're not able to clear that out, whether it's job opportunities that are not being presented to us, or whether it's simply the fact that from Indiranagar to another place, if I have to travel, if the metro wasn't there, there's too much traffic for something that takes me 5 to 10 kilometers, I have to spend an hour, hour and a half in traffic. And apart from which, a predominant form of discussion has been giving women in Karnataka the right to travel in public buses for free. And a lot of youngsters have a very mixed opinion on it, because a lot of youngsters use public transport to travel to their colleges. So yeah, those are the things that are usually discussed within the college areas.
Is there clarity on what are local issues? What are issues that your MP is supposed to take up, right? Because many times we don't know if when the road in front of a house is not in a great shape, who should I blame? Should I blame my corporator, my MLA or MP? So is there clarity on those kind of issues?
Well, first of all, I'd like to disagree with what he said about... you know, young people reading newspapers and that being their source. I really don't think so, because the current generation is such that our attention span is very small thanks to algorithms and everything else. So the easiest way to target young voters is to disguise certain news, like let's say we have a lot of news, based Instagram pages. who have a, you know, a mass agenda, whether it be right or left, and they use that for their benefit. For example, a lot of people, you know, like, let's say there was recently an issue of a young woman being killed by a Muslim man, and a Muslim girl being killed by a Hindu man. So what these news channels, these news pages do is that they communalize the issue. And young people do not have the time, nor do they have the attention span to actually go and look into the issue and actually see what's happening. So when we come to such, like, you know, general issues where there's a lack of attention, I don't think there would be an attention towards local issues. And a lot of teenagers who are actually, or especially people who are in their 20s or their, you know, teenagers or their early 20s and late 20s, those who actually do have an opinion come from marginalized communities where problems actually matter to them, where they actually see, you know, things affect them. Whereas students who actually, like, go to colleges and
affluent
colleges don't really have a problem with that. They don't really care about it. Hence, they don't look at newspapers.
There is a class divide in terms of news consumption. Yeah.
There's definitely a class divide. And there's also a predominant influence of political parties with news channels. So that's what I'd like to say. And with regards to local issues, of course, those belonging to a particular state or a particular community do have certain ideas of it, but they do not have the awareness of who to go complain it to. The basic awareness is lacking.
Okay. I'll just take one question about water, because the water crisis in Bengaluru is quite dire. Who do you blame? Because, of course, the BJP blames it on the Congress. The Congress says the BJP should have come up with a distress formula when they were in power for 4 years. What were they doing? Do you blame any party, or do you think none of them did enough and Bangalore is suffering, or the people themselves are responsible?
I think it's an entire problem with the society that we live in itself. We do not care about nature, and we do not care about water conservation. We do not care about usage of water. Even now on my street, I see people washing their cars every single day. And there is nobody who comes and checks. Like, BBMP is supposed to fine them 5,000 rupees, but that has never happened, I think. And so this is like an entirely systemic problem. I think 15 years back, actually, I think when BJP's Vijay Kumar was here, even now you might see places where the water drainage seepage hole is there. I think he did something long back, and after that, be it Congress or BJP, they've entirely forgotten about it.
Right. One quick round, I want to ask people, all of them are citizens of Bengaluru, tell us one myth that people outside Bengaluru think about Bangalore and it's not true. For example, like I started off the conversation with, they think Bengaluru South is all about Baswangudi, the flower market and masal dosa. Can you think of one such myth? Maybe about startups or something.
About startups, I don't know, I think... Maybe about the weather. I think now we know that it's not true at all. That's the easiest thing.
Ouch.
Yeah. About startups, I think Hyderabad is catching up fast. Chennai is catching up fast. So Bangalore is losing that spot as well. Mm-hmm. But it's good that other places also are coming up. But Bangalore is definitely not the startup capital anymore.
Ma'am, you speak to varied groups of people. Tell us, tell people outside of Bangalore what they believe one thing is not true.
Many people outside think that Bangalore is all about shopping complexes and malls.
Yeah.
And when we first came to Jayanagar Fort Block, we were so astonished when we went further to see Nakal Bande.
Right.
Nakal Bande is a huge slum of 500 families on a Bande.
Yeah.
I mean, this is Bangalore. So most people, when they come to Bangalore, they come from the airport. They see the better part of Bangalore, the MG Road and UB City and all that. And in fact, some people ask me, where are you working? Do you say there are slums in Bangalore? So unlike Bombay, it's sharp, you know, you can easily
see. Because you get off the airport and Dharavi is right
there. You cannot avoid seeing that. So this is the myth that is there, that Bangalore is such a wonderful city. We don't have to rub shoulders with the poor. We can stay our own way. And, you know, and the other myth is about cleanliness. I don't know, that myth is going slowly, but there was this myth about cleanliness, about greenery, of course.
Yeah.
There's still some greenery left. But that myth about trees and, you know, and especially this part of South Bangalore, because there were these avenues, there were these kind of establishments, and especially independent houses.
Right. Anisha, you want to bust one myth?
Several, if I could take the time. One is about culture. I mean, like, you know, people think Bangalore is pub city, breweries, beer, etc., jazz music, hard rock cafe and all of that. But there's also like, I mean, I wasn't able to profile them very well in the story, but there's also people like John Surya and Pasha Bhai also.
Tell us who they are for viewers who don't know.
They're rappers, upcoming. Pasha Bhai raps in Dakhni. Surya John is trying to figure out his scene along with his band, which they call Big Bang, after, well, you know, the great creation of the universe and so on. And so they rap in Tamil, they rap in English, and it's a mix. And they also have one band member who's Udiya. And so, yeah, there is that also. Another myth, RCB recently lost. So football has become a predominant sport now because of the IPL and so on. But Bangalore has its very own underground football tournament in Bangalore East, which, by the way, the News Minute had covered a few years ago. So it happens in Bangalore East on that parade, and there are so many urban legends about that particular football tournament. It's called Independence Tournament. So the final happens on August 15th, and there is that. Last one is, say, Electronic City Flyover. On either side of that road, really long road if my memory serves correct, there are large colonies of people where, you know, there's mostly women. And they're all garment workers, garment factory workers, and they live there in tiny one-room houses. And that is something that the flyover hides. So that's my list for now.
Right. Two quick Bangalore myths that you want to...
The first one, as ma'am said, it's not all about RCB. There's a very good underground football culture that's growing, whether it's HL, whether it's ITI. There have been multiple leagues that have come up. And in fact, there are teams that have gone on to... Now, for example, if I'm not wrong, there's a team that's now from Bangalore qualified into the I-League. That's the second tier of Indian football. And it's a rare thing because you have BFC at the top and you have something and you have a team that's there. The second thing that I like to say is that not when you look at Bangalore, not everything is Vidyarthi or not everything is CTR. It's also about Mahesh Refreshments. It's also about Shivaji Military Hotel. It's a very unique cuisine that's present only to Bangalore and to particular areas of Bangalore, simply because of the fact that there's a large predominant population there, whether it's in Shivaji Nagar, you have a lot of wrestlers that used to live there, whether it's City Market and all of that. So you have a lot of, you know, Pehlwan food, typically meat-consuming, meat-rich food. Then you have, whether it's Indranagar, a lot of people wouldn't know. There's a restaurant called Karthik's that serves chole bhature only on Sundays, so which has a predominantly northern Delhi population. So all of that is a predominant influence, and it's not only
cosmopolitan mix
yes,
of
it's
of
not only
food.
Masala dosa.
Right. What's yours?
Well, the first one being that, I mean, the only one being that the shining capital of India, like the IT capital, Silicon Valley. Yeah. But the problem lies here of the pervading caste issue, the class issue, the very horrible state of women, like the safety for women. And also about how, I think these are some of the main glaringly important issues. And just because a party that, you know, doesn't divide based on communal issues that has come to power doesn't mean that communal issues aren't, you know, pervading our state.
Right.
Yeah.
One from me, since we're talking so much about food, there's so much spoken about the Hyderabadi biryani, Ambur biryani. We also have our own Nati style Donne biryani. If you're in Bengaluru, we have lots of outlets across the city. I'd urge you to go and try them out. But one myth about Bangalore that is unfortunately true is our traffic. It is indeed as terrible as everybody told you. In fact, it's worse. So next time you come to Bangalore, just check the metro route perhaps. That's it from me and all of us. Thank you for joining. If you're a voter in Bengaluru, do not take it as a holiday. It's not a vacation. You can spend time with your family after that, but go and vote. And that's, I think, from all of us. Right, guys?
Yes.
Vote. Thank you for joining us.
This election season, your right to choose puts you at the heart of it again.
We'd like to be your eyes and ears.
Choose the journalism and media that serves democracy and you.
Simply log on to newslaundry.com/2024 election fund and choose an amount of your choice for the reports of your choice.